Hi YouTube, my name's Jeff and today I'm going to be talking about using waste vegetable oil, not in my car as usual, but in a waste oil burner. I'm using this one to run a small home furnace to melt and recycle metals for use in other projects. If you want to know how to build a simple but very effective waste oil burner, then keep watching. There's lots of videos out there on the subject of building oil burners, but I found most of these to be too complex or lacking in detail. This oil burner is very simple. There's no exact dimensions and it's built from spare parts, but the thing is it works very well. It's carbon neutral, burns a waste product and generates high temperatures. It can be used for a variety of purposes. I've been using this one recently to melt soda cans, recycling the aluminium or aluminium as our US friends like to say, for use on other projects. There's no moving parts and no specific dimensions, so it's an easy DIY construction for anyone out there with a few spare plumbing parts. So let's have a quick look at what we're actually going to build. It doesn't look particularly complex, and that's because it isn't. It's basically just a few pieces of pipe put together. Now I have put some dimensions and materials on there, but as I say, these are approximate. These are only there because they're what I had to hand. You can use whatever you've got. The most important thing there is the steel pipe, as that's going to actually go inside the furnace. That's going to get very hot. And whilst the copper pipe will probably deal with it, you're better off with steel, and you want something nice and wide. 1.5 to 2 inch diameter is perfect, really. What is important at this point is what's going on inside that steel pipe. As you can see, there's an internal copper pipe, and this narrows towards one end. It tapers inwards. It narrows to form a smaller aperture. Now, the upper pipe introduces the oil. Now, this trickles in quite slowly. It's not a fast process. And this trickling oil drops down in front of that narrowing pipe, that narrowing aperture. Now, that narrowing pipe, that actually introduces air that blasts in through a thick pipe which tapers down to a thin aperture, which jets the air out, basically speeding the airflow up, if you like. That speeding air hits the dripping oil, that creates a misting effect. It blasts through that dripping oil and creating a fine spray, or at least as fine a spray as we can achieve with this level of technology. And certainly it's good enough for this process. As you've seen from the earlier footage, it really does work. Right, so let's get on with the build. What we need is a blower, something to create the airflow. Now, what I've used here is a simple air pump. This is the sort of thing that inflates blow-up mattresses, children's swimming pools, that kind of thing. The only problem with these kind of blowers, of course, is the fact that we can't control the air, and we need to be able to control the air. We need to be able to fine-tune the amount of air that hits our burner. So we can do this very simply with a T-junction and a normal quarter-turn shut-off valve. The air, of course, wants to travel in a straight line, but by introducing a shut-off valve, we can actually prevent this. We could make it more difficult for the air to go in the one direction, and it will take the easier path. It will change direction and allow us to control the airflow. The amount that we turn the valve will determine how much air actually passes out through this outlet. It's a very simple way of controlling the airflow. Now here you can actually see this in operation. The air, of course, is flowing through this pipe and is jetting out in the one direction, as we would expect. You can see that air coming out there, but if we turn this quarter valve, we change the direction of the air, and it no longer wants to come out that way, but will come out the other direction, which is exactly what we want. And by controlling that lever valve, we control the airflow. So let's look at what we actually need here. Here's our steel pipe, nice thick, about 1.5 inches diameter. It's a bit rusty, but it's perfect for our needs, no problem here. What you can see in the background there is our 22mm copper pipe. And what I've also got here is just a bit of a plumbing part. I think that's for a hose, but it narrows down the airflow nicely. Now, here you can see why we want to narrow it. The air is coming out of that pipe. You can see the air pressure's there, but it's not particularly good. See, it's barely touching that. But watch what happens when I narrow the aperture, actually make it smaller. Suddenly there's much more air pressure there. It jets that little bit of aluminium, whatever it is, and pushes it well out of the way. Look, here you can see I've actually attached that nozzle now to this 22mm bit of pipe. I've soldered it. You don't necessarily have to. It's up to you. What we really need to think about is centralising this copper pipe within the steel pipe. We want it to sit nice and central, float somewhere in the middle there. And we can achieve this very simply. What I decided to use was a bit of MDF, a simple bit of wood, to plug this one end. So I took a circular hole saw and I cut out a little MDF disc, as you can see here, and in the centre of that disc I cut a hole that's the same diameter as the pipe. Now if I take the pipe, you'll see that it fits nice and snug and that will support it. And we can actually bond that pipe in place in a moment using adhesive. Here I'm actually using a two-part epoxy adhesive, and that will secure it nicely to the steel piping. Now that alone probably won't be enough, but we'll come back to that in a moment. Now you can see that this smaller diameter copper pipe fits neatly into that hole at the top, and this is where we're going to introduce our oil. So I take some simple copper fittings and I make myself up a little bit of bendy pipe, as you can see here. Now, why bendy? Well, it's just to keep most of the pipe away from the heat of the furnace. And what we're also going to do now is we're going to put a simple pipe clip on there to support it, like that. That holds it all nice and snug. All that remains now is to glue the internal pipe inside, and again we'll use the two epoxy adhesive, but you'll see I've put some cellophane on the end of that nozzle. Now that's going to become clear now. What we're going to use to support that pipe, in addition to the little bit of MDF and the adhesive, is a mix of my own creation. It's one part finishing plaster and one part ready mixed mortar. Now this stuff produces a nice sort of concreteish material that's very heat resistant. You can see I've put some here in a bit of old can, and I tried blasting it with a blowtorch and it didn't even get warm. It was great stuff. So by packing this stuff inside our steel tube here, around the nozzle, we can help support the whole thing. Obviously we don't want to fill our nozzle, so that's why we've applied the cellophane to the end there. So we just simply add water to our little mix here, and then we pack it all inside our tube, and there we go, magic television, overnight it's set. Fantastic. And there's our finished product. Not looking too bad, is it? And that's pretty much it. We've got ourselves a finished product. If you want any more advice on building an oil burner, you could do worse than look up oil burner on YouTube. There you'll see videos by a mad Aussie bloke. He's a great fella. And what he does know about oil burners isn't worth knowing. He's got some mad contraptions there. And he gives us such fantastic safety tips as not putting our head inside a furnace. Wonderful stuff. There's a lot of good stuff there, so it's worth looking out for oil burner on YouTube. Now, if you want to build a foundry, you could do a lot worse than look up Grant Thompson on good old YouTube there. He's the king of random, and his little video on how to build a mini metal foundry is excellent, a wonderful tutorial. But if you want to bear with me now, I'm going to actually light our little oil burner. Now, to do this, of course, I'm going to need a feeder. I'm going to need to be able to introduce the oil. And this I've done here on a very temporary basis, and I use the word temporary, a little plastic bottle, just so you can see what's going on. I would use something a bit more substantial than this as your feeder tank, but whatever your feeder tank is, do remember you need a little hole at the top, otherwise it'll just create a vacuum and won't drip the oil. And here you can see the setup. There's my furnace, looking a bit worse for wear, it's been well used recently, and there's the oil gravity fed system. So we'll open that little tap and allow the oil to trickle in. You can see the air pump in the background there, and you can see our air burner all in, our oil burner all in place there. Now, to start this is not a self-igniting system, remember that. So you'll need a fire inside your furnace first. We need to achieve a temperature of 300 degrees Celsius, roughly speaking. Now we'll do this using charcoal and little bits of wood. So we light ourselves a fire, we turn on our blower, and we're just letting nature take its course. We really haven't got much charcoal and wood in there. It is just about an inch layer, it's a tiny little thing. But the important thing is we increase the airflow slightly over about 20 minutes, and gradually the insides of that furnace there will get very hot. As you can see there, that's white hot. Once it's white hot, roughly about 300 degrees, we can then introduce the oil. Again, slowly. This is a trickle effect. It's not about speed. If you bear with me here, you'll see I'm turning this tap very, very slowly. I really want the oil to come out just a trickle. And you might just about, there you go, you just about see the trickle there. And after a few more minutes, that's the result. You can see the waste oil burns beautifully. And you can use this to generate whatever you want in your furnace. And there we go, folks. It's as simple as that. How to build an oil burner from just spare parts you might have knocking around. And please do remember, though, when you just saw that video, it was for demonstration purposes. So I did use transparent plastic pipes, and I did use a transparent feeder. I wouldn't recommend you use that. I'd use metal, because these things get very hot, and plastic will melt very quickly in these temperatures. I would also suggest that you use a gate valve to introduce your oil. And with a gate valve, you can really fine-tune the amount of oil that comes into that feeder pipe. And we don't need much oil, you'd be surprised. If you put too much oil inside your burner, believe it or not, you'll just put the fire out that's in there and you cool it off. Oil doesn't burn as well as people think. It's the vapours that burn, hence the importance of the airflow. Now, do experiment with the air and oil mix until you find that happy medium, until it's burning nice and hot for you without using too much oil. The less oil you use, of course, then the more fire you've got for longer. Now, an important safety tip, of course, is don't use water on an oil fire. I know it's a daft thing, but people can do this, and oh, there's so many fires every year in the kitchen with people putting water into a hot chip pan and stuff like that. Never throw water on an oil fire. I keep a bucket of sand handy, or some damp towel, something like that. Just use your sense. We don't want anybody getting hurt in this sort of thing. Now, that's it, folks. If you could subscribe to my videos, it would be much appreciated, as it helps me spread the good word of VegOil motoring. So thank you very much for watching. If you've got any questions, do get in touch. I'm always happy to help. I'm not an expert, as I always maintain. I'm just a happy little amateur who'll try his best. So again, thanks for watching.